This is ABC7 News at 7, your Suncoast News. We're here for you.
See all these motorcycle riders that get into these accidents, and obviously, if they're not wearing helmets, their head pops open like a watermelon.
Could a new law help save lives? One Florida House member says it should be mandatory for bikers to wear a helmet and is filing legislation to make it law. Tonight, we'll break down how it could impact safety on the roads, treatment in trauma centers, and your insurance rates. Good evening, everyone. I'm Alan Cohn, and welcome to ABC 7 at 7. We'll have more on motorcycle safety coming up, but first, our top 7 stories at 7. There aren't just dangers for motorcycle riders in Florida. A new study ranks our state as the most dangerous for pedestrians. And the Suncoast is among the worst metropolitan areas for those who walk or ride a bike. The Dangers by Design 2016 study looked at 104 metro areas in the U.S. The Bradenton, Sarasota, and Northport metro area ranks 10th. Nationwide for the number of pedestrian deaths between 2005 and 2014, our area had 150 pedestrians killed on the roadways. Florida Highway Patrol says the numbers tell a story.
We continue to have more and more tourists. What does a tourist want to do? They want to walk around. Everyone vying for the same space. That is why the stats have risen.
Sarasota County is launching a new program called Walk Wise to educate pedestrians about ways to stay safe. Venice police are investigating how a man died while on a landscaping job. Police say Raimundo Cavillo was trimming a tree on Village Circle for his employer, Beach Tree Landscape Maintenance. A large branch gave way and hit Cavillo and the ladder, which caused him to fall to the ground. Investigators believe it was an accidental death. Good news, bad news in the fight for affordable housing on the Suncoast. The old Knight's Inn on U.S. 41 in Bradenton is reopening as Robbins Apartments. The 180 units on the property have been turned into economy-sized apartments. Rents are $625 a month, including utilities. There is also a plan to build even more units on the 10-acre property. Developer Harvey Vengroff's son Travis is managing the property.
We're really happy when we're able to give someone a chance and you take a chance on someone and they do right by you and they actually go on to succeed.
Any expansion to the property will require zoning approval from Manatee County's Planning Commission. Vengroff plans to make his case to commissioners next month. On the other hand, progress in Sarasota, not so much. Harvey Vengroff says he is pulling the plug on plans to build hundreds of affordable apartments in Sarasota. Vengroff wanted to build 368 units off of Fruitville Road with rents as low as $650 a month. He says the city commission made it too difficult for him to move ahead with the project. Vengroff calls the request by commissioners like random inspections ridiculous. Ironically, Sarasota County is releasing its annual report for 2016 calling for more affordable housing, among other initiatives. The report analyzes projects the county considers essential for improving the area. Some of those projects include improving resources for the homeless, updating the Venice Library, making road improvements, and preparing for the World Rowing Championships. To see the complete report, just visit our website at mysuncoast.com. New developments in the dredging debate between Lido and Siesta Key. Tonight, Siesta residents are holding a meeting to decide their next move as the city of Sarasota and Army Corps prepare to take sand from Big Pass. The Siesta Key Association says it plans to challenge the permit from the Department of Economic Protection. Lido is in dire need of renourishment after being battered by Tropical Storm Colin and Hurricane Hermine. But those on Siesta worry dredging could damage their beach.
Everyone's going to come to the table. We're going to find a reasonable solution that benefits both Siesta and Lido, and it's going to probably take a little bit of time.
Earlier this week, the Sarasota County Commission announced it would not take any legal action against the project. We'll have more details on tonight's meeting coming up at 11. The Manatee County Fair is returning to Palmetto, but with some added security. Organizers are working with law enforcement to create a contingency plan in the event of a shooting or other type of attack. Visitors with concealed carry permits will be allowed to bring firearms onto the grounds.
We want this to continue to be a family affair. We want families to be able to come out and have a safe, wonderful time, and again, make those memories that will last a lifetime.
The fair opened today and will continue through January 22nd. And how is the weather for the fair, Bob?
Well, I can tell you this. After covering the fair for many years, decades in fact, we always see a strong cold front come around this time of year that causes some problems with the Manatee County Fair. But right now, it doesn't appear to be too bad for the opening day, which was today, and continuing on through the weekend, things are looking pretty good. We'll get more into that extended forecast a little bit later. Right now, it's comfortable out there, 67 degrees and northeast wind at 5, and the pressure that continues to rise at this hour. That's way up there, 32, and 61% on the humidity. A few showers east coast and sprinkles inland, but not much going on here. Skies a little bit sunnier today. That allowed temperatures to soar into the low 80s, well above the average. And as far as the overall picture goes, the satellite and radar combination showing you not much over the southeast United States. All is fairly quiet there. And that is, again, a result of this east to southeasterly wind around the high-pressure ridge kind of holding that cold air off well to the north of us. So we're not going to see that come down here anytime soon. Temperatures right now in the 60s and 70s. 60 in Tallahassee. That's cooler reading. 75 now in Miami, the warmer reading. And 67 in Lake Placid, the same in Sarasota. 70 Northport. Miami City at 72. Lakewood Ranch is at 70 right now. And 68 in Bradenton. Cortez at 65. So all in all, pretty nice, beautiful day today. I was out at Anna Maria Island City Pier. Alan, it was just gorgeous out there with lots of sunshine and beautiful mild temperatures.
Absolutely idyllic.
Yeah, you got to take advantage of it, right?
Thanks a lot, Bob. And still to come, helmets are shown to save the lives of motorcycle riders, but should it be mandatory to wear them? We'll show you why a Florida House member is pushing a new legislation to do just that. The story when we return.
Two years ago, my son was born. Now he's running, playing, and learning to speak. When I look at him, I can't help but to see how free he is. I want my son to have the same freedom when he grows up. Protect our freedom of speech, not just for us, but for the future generations.
All hands on deck.
What's up?
I want to point out three tips for using the home computer more safely.
Point away.
First, stop. Make sure your software is up to date and that you've password protected your computer's login and Wi-Fi connection.
Next, think before visiting a site, opening attachments, or clicking on links.
Then connect, knowing you're helping make the web safer for you
and for everyone. Make Stop, Think, Connect part of your daily online routine.
On your TV, on your computer, on your camera, on your smartphone, on your Apple Watch. And now you can get ABC7, your Suncoast News on Fire TV. Just go to mysuncoast.com and click on the mobile tab for a list of fast and free downloads that deliver ABC7, your Suncoast News, on the go.
Check out My Suncoast Dining on mysuncoast.com, your guide to the foodie lifestyle. ABC7's own Chef Judy serves up her favorite recipes, cooking tips and trends, dining blog, step-by-step videos, and Suncoast restaurant guide. You'll find it all at mysuncoast.com/dining.
That will look great on you. Every time you shop here, you have the power to change lives.
Does she work here?
No, she's just a proud supporter of Goodwill.
We are going to build a great society where no man or woman are the victim of fear or poverty or hatred, where every man and woman has a chance for fulfillment and prosperity and hope.
Once upon a time, it was mandatory in Florida for motorcycle riders to wear helmets. Why? To prevent them from cracking open their heads if there was an accident. Republican Governor Jeb Bush got rid of that law. Now, a Republican state representative wants to once again make it mandatory. ABC's Christopher Brantley explains why.
It wasn't always legal for motorcycle riders to ride without a helmet. It was Governor Jeb Bush who allowed riders to go sans helmet, saying at the time it was a matter of choice, freedom to let the wind blow back your hair on the open road. But at the same time, it's also dangerous to ride without a helmet.
It does save head injuries. Now, that's a personal opinion of mine.
Assistant Northport Police Chief Mike Pelfrey is a motorcycle rider himself. He always wears a helmet, but for a reason us non-motorcycle riders may not think of.
I've had a couple of nicks, a couple of little pieces of gravel come up off the roadway when I'm riding. So it's more for that as opposed to falling off the bike or having a wreck.
Pelfrey worries about being distracted by debris while riding, which he says could lead to an accident. As it stands, in Florida, riders are not required to wear a helmet if they're over 21 and have at least $10,000 in medical insurance. However, a new bill filed in the Florida House by Republican State Representative Don Hatfield would require riders to wear helmets.
You see all these motorcycle riders that get into these accidents, and obviously, if they're not wearing helmets, their head pops open like a watermelon.
The Suncoast's newest state representative, Joe Gruder, says he's not sure which way he'll vote.
I'll probably seek out community support from all sides on this before I make a decision. But it's a tough one because you want to give people their individual right to make that decision.
Making Gruder's decision tougher is the law that says motorcyclists in Florida don't have to have liability insurance. So imagine you're not wearing a helmet and that gravel assistant Chief Pelfrey was talking about hits you in the face and you crash. Your medical is covered, but not all the damage you caused by crashing.
We're seeing increases across the board, and if you have a lot of uninsured drivers out there, which we do in Florida, and throw motorcycles into that mix, if they're not required to carry coverage, they're not breaking the law, but they may choose not to have insurance, and that cost is being paid by someone. So that can absolutely impact our auto premiums.
David Joyner of Joyner Family Insurance suggests most of his clients pay for liability insurance just in case. Could requiring helmets cut down on some of that increase? Well, maybe so, says Joyner. In the meantime, Assistant Chief Pelfrey thinks the helmets can save lives.
I have witnessed a couple of people who, in my opinion, were probably saved by the use of their helmet. The cracking of the helmet, it saves the head.
Coming up on the Trapezoid, we'll have it all covered, from a trauma center doctor to the founder of a motorcycle driving school to a representative of the insurance industry. Stay with us.
The agents at SWC would like to show you pictures of all the homes that they've sold quickly for their clients. But they're just too many to show. Contact SWC today and find out for yourself. We just market your home better.
Our goal is to do things better than anybody in the country. What makes Sarasota Memorial Hospital's program so special is that it's taking care of the patient in every aspect of cardiovascular disease. And in this community, the patients are very active. The idea is not just to get them over that operation, but to get them back to doing the things that they enjoy doing.
It's time to go boating, but first, don't miss the 16th annual Charlotte County Boat Show, January 12th to the 15th at the Charlotte County Fairgrounds. Show admission is free and on-site parking is only $5. January 12th to the 15th. Visit GoBoatingFlorida.com for more information.
I heard about the Dottoli Cancer Center through friends of mine who had been treated here and were very pleased with the treatment.
If there is prostate cancer, we at the Dottoli Cancer Center will find it using 3D color flow Doppler ultrasound.
And that helped precisely identify where my cancer was. I can tell you that you will not find a finer, more professional team of clinicians anywhere in the world.
Is your mop a dirty, disgusting mess?
You need the Hurricane 360 Spin Mop System, the only mop and bucket that spins the dirt away. A system that cleans practically anything and everything with super absorbent microfiber. Dip it in the washer side and the mess releases into the bucket. Then place it in the dryer side and push on the pedal. You get a clean mop head that's practically dry and ready for more. And your hands will never again touch a dirty, disgusting mop. The heads are washable and reusable. Get the Hurricane 360 Spin Mop System for just two payments of $19.99. You'll also get a Sticky Buddy, the reusable sticky roller that picks up pet hair and lint and washes clean in seconds. You can take advantage of our 2-for-1 pick it up special and get a second spin mop set. Just pay additional shipping and fee. And we'll upgrade you to free priority handling. So don't wait. Order now.
Call 1-800-394-1524 to get your Hurricane Spin Mop double offer. So hurry and call 1-800-394-1524. Call now.
Welcome back. So just how dangerous is it to ride a motorcycle in Florida? According to the Florida Department of Highway Safety and Motor Vehicles, in 2015, there were more than 10,000 motorcycle crashes. 546 of them were fatal. The Centers for Disease Control reports helmets reduced the risk of death by 37% and the risk of head injury by 69%. And joining us for more on Bikers Wearing Helmets is Jim Gillette, founder of Ride Safe USA Sarasota, Dr. Alan Brockhurst, medical director of the Trauma Center at Sarasota Memorial Hospital. And joining us by Skype is Lynn McChristian, Florida representative for the Insurance Information Institute. Thank you all for joining us. And Jim, thank you for bringing props. That's always good.
You're quite welcome. Lynn,
let me start with you because part of the law that is being proposed is because of the impact it is having on the insurance industry and the premiums of all of us who pay premiums. Could you explain that a little bit?
Sure. All insurance is the cost of claims. So when you have claims rising and injuries rising, that raises the price of insurance. So as there's more fatalities, more accidents, more injuries, that's increasing the price that everyone pays for insurance. So to have measures in place to lower those tragedies, that's a good thing that will help lower the cost of insurance.
Jim, this law was changed 16 years ago before it was mandatory. Did we not know back then that this would likely happen?
We should have known. And it was assumed that riding behavior would not necessarily translate to as many accidents as we do have. We failed to look at rider behavior at the time.
Bring us back then. I remember the argument. I was working in Florida then, and I seem to remember that it was about freedom, about getting out on the open road and letting, as we said, the wind blow back your hair.
This was all about choice, our rights to choose and not have the government dictate.
But there was a downside to that.
There was indeed.
Okay. Doctor, you see that downside every day, and you are a motorcycle rider yourself.
I am.
How often do you see accidents in the ER that a helmet would have made the difference?
I think that it's fairly frequent. We've seen around 220 motorcycle accidents since Sarasota became a trauma center. Some of them are routine where the trauma service is not even involved, but most of them that we've seen are more serious, and in general, the head protection would help.
Are you able to quantify or characterize the difference between someone who had a motorcycle accident wearing a helmet and the impact if they're not?
I don't think that, again, there's that hard data out there. I don't have that kind of on the tip of my tongue, but, it definitely makes a difference, especially at the higher speeds.
Lynn, is that something that you keep track of?
We don't keep track of it, but the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration does, and they have data on their website that shows that helmets do make a difference. They're the difference between people being able to walk away and to recover from a traffic crash. So they do make a difference, and there's data that shows that helmets on average can save, according to the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, they can save several hundred lives a year. 700, over 700 was the last number that I saw.
And Jim, you teach motorcycle safety.
Yes, I do.
It's mandatory.
Absolutely.
Do you have a position on helmets?
I have a position, because based on the National Highway Traffic Safety studies, we found or have learned that 37% of the time, the operator's life would have been spared, or could have been spared, if he had he or she had used a helmet, and 41% of the time, the passenger would have survived. So therefore, as far as we're concerned, traffic, the minute you are in traffic and exposed to other riders and the elements, you should wear a helmet.
Briefly, what kind of feedback or pushback do you get from your students?
From my students during the course, I don't get any pushback, simply because in order to take the class that is required by the state of Florida, you have to have proper gear. The state mandates that every student is properly attired.
So nobody says, well, you know, I'll do that for your class, but when I'm out of here, I'm going to take it off?
We do hear that on occasion.
Okay. We are just getting started with this conversation. More on requiring bikers to wear helmets is coming up, along with a check on our weather forecast, so stay with us.
Come meet the artists and enjoy their creations at the Sarasota Fine Art Festival. Over 100 artists and thousands of works of contemporary art in photography, glass, sculpture, jewelry, and much more. The 5th Annual Sarasota Fine Art Festival, Saturday and Sunday, January 14th and 15th, on Main Street between Osprey and Orange Avenues in downtown Sarasota. Bring your love and appreciation of art to the Sarasota Fine Art Festival. For more information, visit ParagonArtEvents.com.
Get the new year off to a great start with safety and peace of mind. Subaru was named the 2016 Best Overall Brand, Most Trusted, and Best Performance Brand by Kelley Blue Book. And ALG named Subaru its top mainstream brand for residual value for 2016. Now you can lease a new Subaru Outback for just $229 a month, or get 0% financing with complimentary maintenance included. Get more for your money. Go to Sunset Subaru in Sarasota.
Start the year off with a great deal during the Start Something New event going on now at Sunset Dodge Chrysler Jeep Ram in Sarasota. Ram trucks are built tough and have plenty of power to handle any job, with all the comforts you'd expect in a luxury vehicle. And right now, all 2016 quad cabs are over 20% off, with new Ram trucks starting at just $19,999. Better prices, bigger selection. Go to Sunset Dodge Chrysler Jeep Ram in Sarasota.
Go ahead. Make a fashion statement. Demand something more than just ordinary. Capture elegance in every turn and drive with flair, where beautiful styling is standard. Stop in and take a test drive. I'll guarantee you'll never go back to plain vanilla again. The all-new 2017 Fiat 500, starting at $14,999. Only at Sunset Fiat in Sarasota.
What does it mean when New South Window says factory direct?
It means we have a factory.
It means we eliminate the middleman.
It means you get an award-winning, energy-efficient window at factory direct pricing.
Plus, New South Windows are made in Florida.
For Florida homes.
By Florida workers.
Because we know Florida weather.
Bring your measurements this Saturday from 9 to 4 to get huge discounts. New South Window. We manufacture. We install. We guarantee. Call now.
Our discussion of whether or not bikers should be required to wear helmets continues in a moment, but first let's get the check on our forecast from Chief Meteorologist Bob Harrigan. Bob.
Well, it's been a beautiful day for riding bikes, motorcycles, or even hanging out by the water, catching some fish. This is a Bimini Bay and beautiful shot there. Anna Maria webcam showing the flat, calm seas out there. Winds very light out of the east at 5 to 10 knots. Not much of a breeze out there right now, in fact, and looks like mostly fair skies are in the forecast for the remainder of this evening. A great photo sent in. This was Damon Powers on Lido Beach getting his version of a sand snowman with the shells as the arms and a shell as a cap. Looks like a golfer. Here's the high pressure ridge now off the east coast now. It's pretty strong too. In fact, really strong. Not going to move much at all over the upcoming week, it looks like. By Thursday next week, we may see a front move on down and bring us a chance for showers then. But until then, looks like we're going to be enjoying some pretty nice weather here along the Sun Coast for January. A few showers along the east coast near Cape Canaveral and places to the south, but not here. We have fair skies, 67 degrees, and the dew point is at 53, which is pretty nice. The pressure 30-32, that's way up there. That continues to rise at this hour. Winds out of the north-northeast light at 5, and the high today was 81. That's 10 degrees above the average, and a low this morning was 55. our normal low, 52 degrees. So it can be kind of cool this time of year, but it hasn't been. Just a couple of days over the weekend. That's been about it. No rainfall to report today, and a little bit of patchy fog may form during the overnight hours, especially inland. But notice temperatures falling down into the upper 50s to low 60s. So again, our normal low, 51. We're going to get down around 60 degrees to start things off tomorrow morning. Well, temperatures currently at 60 already in Tallahassee, 61 in Jacksonville, 68 now in Orlando. It's 75 in Miami, 73 in Key West, and around town, all the way from Sebring to Cortez, 67. Degrees, 67 in Sarasota, a couple degrees warmer in Inglewood now. Northport, you're at 70 and 71 in Port Charlotte. The latest satellite and radar imagery showing a pretty big cold front in terms of cold air behind it, but very warm air out ahead of it. Normally, this would be rainfall. Here we are in January, a couple weeks into it, and we're seeing rain mainly into Kentucky, stretching off to West Virginia, Pennsylvania, and New York. Not much snowfall there. We had a little bit of a rain-snow mix earlier into Illinois, Indiana, and parts of Michigan. But right now, most of that has moved on as temperatures are extremely warm there. This is an amazing story. It continues to be a big problem with heavy snowfall, but not for skiers. They love it, especially in the Sierra Nevada range, although you have to look out for the possibility of avalanches because we've had over 200 inches of snow right there at Lake Tahoe. That's 200 inches. No, 14 feet, and that has occurred since January 1st. Near Lake Tahoe. So, yes, the skiers are digging that. As far as temperatures go, very cold Arctic air still confined mainly to the northern and central U.S. However, this is going to spread a little bit off to the east, not so much to the south over the next couple of days. And as far as wind chill goes, it's a little bit cold, minus 35 degree wind chill factor in Minot, North Dakota. Well, for us, just the balmy upper 70s to near 80 degrees over the upcoming days with just a slight chance for a few inland sprinkles, if you will. For boaters, it looks good. Light chop in the bays and in the water. Seas running 2 feet or less. And a sunrise will be at 7:22 and high tide 11:37. Mostly fair, 58 degrees. And for tomorrow, look for beautiful weather, 79. East winds 5 to 10. The extent of the forecast doesn't get much better than this in January. This is one of the warmest Januarys I can remember. The rain chance at 40% on Thursday. And that is at 40%. But most of the week, pretty nice. Alan will be back right now in just a couple minutes. Stick around.
Are you considering joint replacement or revision surgery? Consider this. Dr. Edward Stolarski has performed thousands of successful joint replacement procedures and trained surgeons from all over the world. Using advanced technologies, Dr. Stolarski is able to perform some of the most complex surgeries.
I wish I knew about Dr. Stolarski much sooner.
After the surgery, I don't have any pain. It's like I've got a 16-year-old hip.
My name's Ed Stolarski. What I really do is I give people back their life.
Schedule a consultation today.
I knew I could get myself out of this. I just needed some hope and some help.
I took the first step to recovery when I made the call.
If you're depressed, drinking, and using drugs, you may need help. And the Affordable Care Act guarantees coverage of substance abuse. Call the Addiction, Hope, and Helpline now for a free assessment.
I had problems just getting to sleep, drinking, and using pills every night.
I feel like I'm losing control. I'm afraid I'll lose my job or even my family.
Are you losing hope? You can recover and get back on track. Call now for hope and help with proven gentle recovery programs.
I never thought that I could be somebody who didn't drink and use drugs.
I have something to hold on to for strength. I'm in recovery, getting the help I need.
Call the Addiction, Hope, and Helpline now for a free assessment with someone who cares.
Call 1-800-764-8708. That's 1-800-764-8708.
I knew I could get myself out of this. I just needed some hope and some help.
I took the first step to recovery when I made the call.
If you're depressed, drinking, and using drugs, you may need help. And the Affordable Care Act guarantees coverage of substance abuse. Call the Addiction, Hope, and Helpline now for a free assessment.
I had problems just getting to sleep, drinking, and using pills every night.
I feel like I'm losing control. I'm afraid I'll lose my job or even my family.
Are you losing hope? You can recover and get back on track. Call now for hope and help with proven gentle recovery programs.
I never thought that I could be somebody who didn't drink and use drugs.
I have something to hold on to for strength. I'm in recovery, getting the help I need.
Call the Addiction, Hope, and Helpline now for a free assessment with someone who cares.
Call 1-800-764-8708. That's 1-800-764-8708.
Welcome back. If you're just joining us, we are discussing new legislation to require motorcycle and moped riders in Florida to wear helmets. Our guests tonight are Jim Gillette of Ride Safe USA Sarasota, Dr. Alan Brockhurst of Sarasota Memorial Hospital, and joining us by Skype is Lynn McChristian of the Insurance Information Institute. Doctor, we've been talking about the numbers, but let our viewers know on a practical basis, how often do you see trauma coming through your emergency room associated with motorcycle accidents?
It's fairly frequent. Our numbers for the past year, around 2,500 traumas that we saw in a one-year time span. About half, roughly, are falls. About 25% are motor vehicles, and around 22% are motorcycles. So from what we see compared to how many cars are on the road to how many motorcycles are on the road, obviously there's far fewer motorcycles, but they're more severely injured, which is why I end up seeing them.
And you are coming right from a motorcycle accident case.
Yep, just came from one, exactly.
Serious.
Yeah, very serious.
I hope they're okay. Jim, you have brought some props, and they are helmets, but they are different. Could you describe them?
Indeed. The different helmets that we brought, one of them is a full face helmet, which provides the best protection for your face and your lower jaw. Then we have a three-quarter helmet, which obviously doesn't protect your chin area that much. And then we have a shorty, which is frequently used, especially when it's hot. People complain about it being so hot, so this is another option that you may have. However, all three of these are DOT-approved helmets versus the last that some diehard non-users wish to wear for protection, which is the headscarf.
You do realize you're getting some people angry out there.
I may. However, It's kind of obvious when we look at these three and then look at the headscarf, which might give you the best protection.
Lynn, does the industry have a position in terms of people who have insurance, whether or not that they wear helmets or can show that they've purchased helmets in terms of their insurance premiums?
They don't have a position right now. They follow what the state law is. Insurance is regulated by the state. So we'll do whatever the law says. But one of the points you brought up early in the broadcast I think is really important is the absence of liability insurance for motorcycle riders. So if you're required to just get the $10,000 for medical payments if you're injured and you don't get liability, if you cause an accident and cause damage to somebody else's property, without liability insurance, all that expense is on your dime. So insurance is really important for your liability proportion to protect your finances, and that's something that everybody should know.
Does your organization have a position on the current bill?
We do not lobby. We're strictly educational. We want people to know what their risks are and take the measures to protect themselves and to protect their finances. That's what we do.
Let's play devil's advocate for a moment. As I was saying, that the bill was changed, or the law was changed 16 years ago for a reason. It came at a time when there was a lot of deregulation. We also got rid of auto emissions here in Florida because people want to have the ability to make these decisions for themselves. So for those who steadfastly believe that, what would you say to them, Doctor?
I would just say that, the statistics aren't on their side and they're kind of taking their lives in their hands. Again, a lot of people, the earlier segment with the Chief Pelfrey, I'm a motorcycle rider, as I said earlier. Very often debris hits the windshield of your car and cracks it. I personally would not want that to hit my face. So I wear the full face shield. When we look at the statistics of where the impact to the head occurs, about 20% of it's to the lower jaw. So even the half face or the kind of turtle shell helmet is not enough protection.
One might say, Jim, or one might ask, that if you're in a severe crash, a helmet is only going to protect you that much. I'm sure that that's what a lot of people at home are saying right now. How would you respond?
Indeed, it is suggested that the helmet may save your life only 37% of the time. But I'd like to be among that 37 percentile. Aside from that, what I think may be brought into discussion is whenever a motorcyclist gets on their motorcycle and they go for a ride, they're never alone. They may not have a physical passenger, but they have other stakeholders. So they want to protect themselves. And the other stakeholders really are family, friends, significant others, mothers, fathers, daughters. So when you look at it as whenever you go on a ride, you're impacting other stakeholders, you may want to protect yourself.
Have you seen attitudes change over the years?
I can't say that I have seen attitudes change, but education does help. I've had several students over the past nearly 8 years give me a call or send me an email, say, hey, you know what, we really appreciated the segment that you spent with us on safety and all the gear all the time. And it has changed some of them to a favorable.
And Lynn, you said that the industry itself has to abide by state rules in whatever states. But, you know, like with your automobile insurance, we see it all the time. If you, you know, plug a certain thing into your car, you get a break on your insurance program. We have these things going on. If you get certain educational classes, you also get breaks. Is there any effort within the industry to do these kinds of things, not only to lower insurance premiums, but also protect the health and safety of motorcycle riders?
Insurance companies are all about education. You can't go to any insurer's website without finding easily available all the information, all the education, all the rationale to do things to protect yourself. So they really do spend a lot of time educating people about that risk. But to be able to force people to do that, again, it's up to the law, and the insurance companies will follow that law, but they'll offer a product to help people protect themselves and to protect their finances. That's what the insurance products are for.
And gentlemen, let me ask you this question. If this law gets passed and we have no idea what will happen, and you know it's being proposed by a Republican member of the State House, you have a Republican legislature here, so but we still don't know what impediments that there will be. Would you expect there to be a significant impact in terms of the numbers of injuries and fatalities in Florida?
I would expect that if the helmets are reenacted, there'd probably be less fatalities. I think the data is clear on that. There's just as many motorcycle crashes, but the nature of the head injury and the C-spine injuries are less if you're wearing a helmet.
What are the most prevalent injuries in a serious motorcycle accident?
Brain injury, traumatic brain injury, and then probably cervical spine and pelvis. Pelvises are injured because of the kind of rapid deceleration hitting the gas tank on the motorcycle.
You know, it just occurred to me. We don't let football players go out on the field without a helmet. And we still have a problem with concussions with football players. Yet we do let people go out on motorcycles driving, you know, 70 miles an hour, but it's not mandatory. There's a little irony there.
Correct.
One of my nurse practitioners used to say, they make us wear a seatbelt in the car, but you can sit on the roof of your car on a motorcycle with not wearing a helmet. So it doesn't make any sense. Right.
So again, if you're involved within the motorcycle community, what kind of pushback do you see out there in terms of wearing helmets these days?
As far as pushback is concerned, you'll always have the diehard rider that doesn't think that they need to wear a helmet because for the past 10, 20, 30 years of their riding experience, they've not been subject to an incident. That means during the times where they were not paying attention, everyone else was watching out for them. That's the unfortunate mindset.
Right, and Lynn, we have less than a minute left, but I want to ask you this. Is there a way to quantify the impact in terms of our insurance premiums for people who do not ride motorcycles but are in effect paying for those who do, who have unfortunate accidents?
Well, some of that winds up being social insurance. So you have trauma centers that might have to take people and take care of them who don't have any insurance, and that's something everybody pays. So again, if people paid and were responsible for their own safety, their own driving behavior, that would lower the cost of insurance for everybody.
Okay, let's take a quick break. When we return, we'll have final thoughts from our guests, plus what some of our viewers are saying about the story that was in the news today.
For more than 100 years, American Humane Association has been teaching kids to be kind to animals. Those in our homes, on the farms, on the silver screen, and wildlife conservation caring for the world's vanishing creatures.
but we can't do it alone. Visit kindness100.org to find ways to teach kids how they can make a more caring, compassionate, and humane world for all of us.
Check out My Suncoast Dining on MySuncoast.com, your guide to the foodie lifestyle. ABC7's own Chef Judy serves up her favorite recipes, cooking tips and trends, dining blog, step-by-step videos, and Suncoast Restaurant Guide. You'll find it all at MySuncoast.com/dining.
They're coming from Tampa, Fort Myers, even Orlando. They're coming from everywhere for the Sarasota Ford Promise. Our promise means a new car you'll love. If not, return it for one you do. At Sarasota Ford, we promise live market pricing. We monitor national pricing on our entire inventory, so you get the best deal. In fact, we guarantee it. Bring us any competitor's ad, and we'll beat it by at least $1,000. That's why they're coming from everywhere to Sarasota Ford, where 41 meets 301. SarasotaFord.com.
Attention small business owners. Penn Funding announces the easiest and fastest business funding program, the Platinum Business Account.
We needed cash fast. Business is good, but this is an emergency. We needed some new equipment, and the banks wouldn't help us.
At Penn Funding, we like to say, yes, you're approved. With your Platinum Business Account, you could qualify for up to $50,000 or more. This amazing new business account funding program is so effective, you could have the cash you need in just days.
I called, spoke with an agent who pre-qualified us, and connected me.
Call now for your Platinum Business Account. If you've been in business for at least 6 months, you could qualify for up to $50,000 or more in just days.
I called Penn Funding and had my money fast.
Need cash for your business? Call Penn Funding now.
Call 800-658-3433. 800-658-3433.
Welcome back. Should motorcycle and moped riders be required to wear helmets? It could happen in Florida if a new bill becomes law. Our guests join us now for final thoughts on the proposal. So, Lynn, make your case.
Well, there's a risk involved with riding without a helmet, and is that risk something that you're going to want to do and to pay for it with your life or with a serious injury? So it's about the risk.
Jim, you teach motorcycle safety. What do you tell your students?
Simply the fact that 37% of the time a fatality can be prevented by way of using a helmet. I think that you should think of the other stakeholders in your life aside from yourself and make the right choice. Protect yourself as much as you can.
Jim, you're in the most interesting position because you are a motorcycle rider yourself, mm-hmm. but you live this every single day in your emergency room. And so what do you want people to keep in mind?
I would say enjoy your motorcycle, have fun, but be safe. Wear the helmet and as much protective gear as possible. It may save your life.
And you see that every day. I mean, you see, fortunately, many accidents are not serious, but you see people who don't come out of it alive.
Yes.
And there's no doubt in your mind that wearing one of these helmets could mean less fatalities.
Absolutely. I've seen it both in my patients, and again, I have friends that are motorcycle riders that have accidents, and many of them, all of them are alive that crash because of their helmet.
Okay. Thank you all very much. Before we go, we want to share with you what some of our viewers are saying about our lead story last night. A 65-year-old woman was shot and killed in Parrish after driving her car through the property gates of a military veteran. The woman's family says she was trying to get her dog back, which was given to the man by her estranged husband. The shooter is now facing charges of second-degree murder. The story has gone viral across the country and around the world. Here is what some of our viewers are saying. Mish Seri writes, "You have the right to stand your ground everywhere in Florida, not just within your home. The law was changed several years ago. If they ram through a locked gate, shame on them." Lauren Ann writes, "People go down there, get away with shootings all the time with that lovely stand your ground law. An 83-year-old man shoots at a car that comes through the smashing through his gate, and he goes to jail." And Rosemary Albee writes, "Sorry, but you crashed through my gate. You get what you deserve. Let the military vet go." Well, if you'd like to join the conversation about tonight's topic, just visit our Facebook page at facebook.com/news@7. And FYI, when the Watch Pass roundtable discussions, they're available on Apple TV, Amazon Fire, and Roku. Thanks for our guests for being here tonight. Jim Gillette is the founder of Ride Safe USA Sarasota. Dr. Alan Brockhurst is medical director for the Trauma Center at Sarasota Memorial Hospital. And Lynn McChristian is the Florida representative for the Insurance Information Institute. When we return, we'll have a final look at your weather, plus an emotional day at the White House as Vice President Joe Biden is awarded the nation's highest civilian honor. Find out how he reacted to the surprise in our primetime headlines.
We're losing exotic animals on a daily basis, and the ones that we have in captivity are really the ambassadors for their wild counterparts. I'm Clayton Rozier from the Big Cat Habitat and Gulf Coast Sanctuary, housing over 150 exotic animals that needed a great home. And if you love animals, please help them. Do it locally. Support your local no-kill shelters, your local wild animal sanctuaries. Make a difference where you can.
Every week on Animal Outtakes, it's a new adventure.
From meeting curious lemurs to feeding big cats and hosing down rhinos, there's never a dull moment. And sometimes these amazing animals chime in. Tune in to Animal Outtakes to find out what they have to say.
Watch Animal Outtakes every week on ABC7.
It's Tampa's most exclusive event of the year, and you're invited. The Morgan Auto Group Charity Polo Classic is back Saturday, February 25th at DI Polo Tour in Plant City. One unforgettable day of luxury and sport with cuisine from Tampa Bay's finest restaurants. Plus, every ticket sold helps a local charity, including the Children's Cancer Center, Ryan Neese Foundation, Close to Kids, and Morgan Auto Group's Helping Hand Fund. Don't miss the Morgan Auto Group Charity Polo Classic. Visit charitypoloclassic.com for tickets and information.
You might feel like there's too many problems in the world, or that, you know, you as a 15-year-old, 16-year-old can't really make a difference.
It's not always about you. It's not just one person. It's a group. It's a team.
Just that simple act is transforming someone else's life.
It's one of the best feelings in the world.
It'll just make you feel so good about yourself.
I'd do anything to convince you just to be a part of this.
Your primetime headlines are coming up in a moment, but right now let's get a final check on our forecast from Chief Meteorologist Bob Harrigan. Bob.
Well, a beautiful sunset tonight along the Sun Coast. We had little clouds around this evening. In fact, you can see the sun setting just before 6 o'clock tonight, making for some spectacular sky conditions there just after sunset. And as far as photos go, well, Art Conforti, who is a regular contributor, sending this photo in tonight after the sun went down below the horizon. Send your photos in to pics@mysuncoast.com, and we'll get them off our Facebook page as well if you post them there. High pressure now continues, and it's going to be the same old story, same old dance, and looks like we're going to see that stay with us right through the weekend. High pressure just off the eastern seaboard there off the southeast United States will provide easterly wind flow, which always has a tendency to bring some cloudiness and some showers, mainly to the east coast of Florida, but those showers are very light and usually occurring in the afternoon and evening. As far as our current conditions go, it's nice. 67, fair skies, and the dew point now, pretty nice at 53 degrees, so it makes it feel comfortable out there. 81 degrees for our high today. At the Sarasota Bradenton Airport, we were in the low 80s. If you went east of I-75, say Lakewood Ranch, Wauchula, Arcadia, all into the low 80s today. Not close to the record, though, 86 set back in 1993. No rainfall, and we'll stay dry, too, it looks like, through the weekend and beyond, although there is a chance of showers that comes into the picture, it looks like late next week, and that chance of rain is pretty significant, I think, on Thursday of next week. Patchy fog overnight. It'll be inland areas as a result of the clear skies and light winds. We'll see some areas of patchy fog, which should not be a big concern. 67 in Pensacola right now. These are current temperatures, 75 still. Pretty nice there in Miami, and temperature 10 degrees cooler at Lake Placid, 70 now in Venice, 67 in Cortez. And the satellite radar review showing a little quick moving system that made its way through Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, and parts of Michigan today. Brought with it some rain, snow, sleet, and even some freezing rain at times. That has all changed over to rainfall for the most part as it makes its way through New York and into Vermont, New Hampshire, Connecticut, and Rhode Island. All getting a little cloud cover today and a little bit of shower activity out west. Not little, but lots of snowfall that is. We showed this earlier.
Just a tremendous amount of rain falling, causing some flooding problems. And obviously, as that air rises up on the Sierra Nevada range, it cools and condenses and turns into snow. And that snow has been incredible. In fact, since January 1st, there's been 200 inches of snow reported near Lake Tahoe. Now, temperature is extremely cold. Air starting to spill southward now into Kansas and Missouri, as well as Illinois and Indiana. That cold air, if you factor in the wind, it feels like minus 35 now, minus 12 in Minneapolis, 14, balmy 14 in Chicago. So if you're visiting from those areas, enjoy this beautiful weather we're seeing here. Although the nation's capital now, it's 67 degrees, same temperature there that it is here right now. Futurecast showing some clouds around now and again throughout the day tomorrow, mainly in the afternoon, but not much going on as far as any significant rainfall goes over the upcoming few days. Northeast winds 5 to 10 knots. And a light chop in the bays and inland waters. The water temperature now at 65 degrees. Low tide will be at 8:06. Sunrise at 7:22. Tonight, mostly fair, mild, 58, well above average for a low. And tomorrow, the warm weather remains beautiful. 79 degrees, some sunshine in the morning, a few clouds in the afternoon. The extended forecast, the nice weather, warm weather right on into the weekend with that rain chance on Thursday. Alan will be back with primetime headlines. Stick around.
Come meet the artists and enjoy their creations at the Sarasota Fine Art Festival. Over 100 artists and thousands of works of contemporary art in photography, glass, sculpture, jewelry, and much more. The 5th Annual Sarasota Fine Art Festival, Saturday and Sunday, January 14th and 15th, on Main Street between Osprey and Orange Avenues in downtown Sarasota. Bring your love and appreciation of art to the Sarasota Fine Art Festival. For more information, visit ParagonArtEvents.com.
Florida's last private island is a waterfront lifestyle like no other. This is Harbor Isle, just 5 minutes from the sugar sand beaches of Anna Maria Island. This sun-splashed paradise invites you to enjoy natural adventures and all the recreation of a tropical resort. Island coach homes and waterfront condos are now available from the high 400s. Don't miss the Luxury by the Bay event, Saturday, January 21st from noon till 4 p.m. at Harbor Isle. Water ski show, luxury cars, wine tasting, model home tours, and more.
Is your old garage door stuck or broken? Would a new one give you a lift? Let Precision Door Overhead Garage Door Service of Sarasota come to the rescue with prompt and affordable repair service. Replacement doors come with an array of styles and colors, and they are rated to meet and exceed Florida standards. From estimates to installation, your satisfaction is our priority. If you're not 100% satisfied with any product, service, or installation, we will make it right, because Precision Door Service is a name you can trust.
I owed the IRS $10,000.
I owed the IRS $20,000.
The IRS garnished my wages.
They put a lien on my house.
The IRS is the most powerful collection agency in the world. They do not give up until you pay.
I couldn't sleep. We were being audited. I called Tax Solutions Now, and a great big weight was lifted off my shoulders.
I called Tax Solutions Now, and they got the IRS off my back.
Tax Solutions Now had my wage garnishment lifted in 48 hours.
Tax Solutions Now can get you help. Our agents know the rules, can stop the pain, and get you the best deal.
We saved our home and overcame the most powerful collection agency in the world.
We connect you with a team of former IRS agents and tax professionals who get the IRS off your back.
Time is running out. Call Tax Solutions Now.
Call 1-800-565-7740. That's 1-800-565-7740.
Now a look at your primetime headlines. We begin in Washington, where the Senate is all confirmation hearings all the time for President-elect Donald Trump's cabinet nominees. Dr. Ben Carson, a one-time Trump rival, is the pick for housing secretary. Meanwhile, Kansas Representative Mike Pompeo, the nominee for CIA director, testified before the Intelligence Committee, and the Senate Armed Services Committee heard from retired General James Mattis, who stressed the importance of civilian control of the military.
Our armed forces in this world must remain the best led, the best equipped, and the most lethal in the world.
Both Pompeo and Mattis took positions different from Trump during the hearings, Pompeo saying he would not bring back torture. Meanwhile, a huge surprise for Vice President Joe Biden today. President Obama presented him with the Presidential Medal of Freedom. The president called him as good a man as God has ever created. The emotional Biden, but he was the only coming to the event to toast senior staff members. He says the honor is beyond what he deserves.
I'm indebted to you. I'm indebted to your friendship. I'm indebted to your family.
And Mr. President, you know, as long as there's a breath in me, I'll be there for you. My whole family will be, and I know it is reciprocal.
Before surprising Biden with the award, Obama praised the vice president, his wife Jill Biden, and his children and grandchildren. Now to Florida's capital, where the state chamber of commerce is backing Governor Rick Scott's proposal to set aside $85 million in tax incentives. The money would go to Enterprise Florida to help recruit out-of-state businesses. The Florida Chamber says 90% of jobs in the state are created without incentives, but using these funds will create better jobs.
When we can compete for those kinds of high-wage, high-skill jobs that leverage our universities and the research and development you heard earlier, in those very limited cases, incentives make sense.
The incentives face opposition from the new Speaker of the House, Richard Corcoran, who calls the program, quote, corporate welfare. State legislators are also debating term limits for judges. Currently, appellate judges and state Supreme Court justices face a merit retention vote every 6 years, but no judge has ever lost one of those votes. The only other way they can be removed is by reaching the mandatory retirement age of 70. A bill filed last year to create a 12-year limit passed in the House but died in the Senate. Now to the latest on the search for the man who killed an Orlando police officer. The manhunt for Markeith Lloyd is now in its fourth day. Three people have been arrested, but not the fugitive. Lloyd's niece, ex-girlfriend, and the fugitive's former co-worker have been arrested for aiding him 2 weeks before his girlfriend's murder. The fugitive posted on Facebook saying he wanted to be on America's Most Wanted. He may be getting close. There's a $100,000 reward for information leading to his arrest. Online retail giant Amazon is announcing plans to hire 100,000 people over the next 18 months. A big chunk of those jobs will be right here in Florida. The company says the majority of those jobs will be at fulfillment centers. Jobs will be full-time with benefits. In the past 5 years, Amazon has hired more than 150,000 people. The hiring surge comes as traditional retailers are cutting jobs and closing stores. Last week, Macy's closed 68 stores, firing more than 10,000 employees, including those here on the Suncoast. And that's all the time we have for this evening. I'm Alan Cohn. Thanks for joining us. Have a great night.